Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come.
Whatever my lot, thou has taught me to say, it is well. Stand and sing it. My sin, know the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is me.
Worship it. For with a blessed assurance, for the constant confidence. There's no gap in his assurance and no lack in his help. Thank you, Lord. Wow, what a presence of the Lord there is in this place. We are here this morning for the first part of this convocation to remember and to try to be a blessing to those families of those who have, since we met last, made it home. You can be seated if you will, and please watch this video.
And I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
As Christians, and especially as ministers, we attend a lot of funerals. It's a part of the privilege as well as responsibility that we take on when we respond to the call of God. I've attended a lot of funerals, and one of the things that seems to grab my heart every time that I attend a funeral is that this family is hurting, and it seems like the world just keeps right on running fast and furious, and in some places they don't even slow down for the hearse anymore because we run at such a pell-mell rate, and you just kind of feel a heavy in your heart, not only because someone has lost someone that is near and dear to them, but it seemed like the world could care less. And then I remember that somebody really does notice and somebody really does care in the highest place in the universe, because it says the Lord notices, and it's actually precious to Him. Precious indeed in the sight of the Lord is the death of His saints. He has a unique chariot, the psalm says, to come by and pick every one of us up. And each one is uniquely detailed for the individual transit that needs to be made by a child of God. I'm glad He didn't tell us all about heaven, and He leaves a little bit of that to our imagination. And especially when we can amp up our imagination with the power of the Holy Spirit, and it makes it so real. And I tell you, we try to honor today those family members of you who are seated here, and many who could not come today that have gone to glory through this past year since we had our last district council. Because it is not just semantics or playing with words, but they count and they matter to us. Not only to you, but to this district, to the churches, to the ministers. And we want to not just make time, we want to really highlight time today, this morning, to say that we try to do a little bit along. We try to be there to present a flag or to have someone, if we can't be there personally, represent us. And we try to make contact with you through cards and things through the years to come, with the booklets. Because regardless of what the world tells you, somebody really does notice today, and somebody really does care. And aren't you glad we can celebrate today as well as remember? Because as I say sometimes, and it causes eyebrows to raise at first, we as Christians, and this isn't just a play on words, we as Christians really don't bury our dead. We plant a seed, because we are fully convinced that the only way the Lord could get us removed from the curse and of sin and death that was axiomatic had to be. He said, I can't remove that. You're going to have to die because Adam sinned. But I have done something that can get you a brand new glorified body that will even transcend what you had already. And you just got to go through this veil of death to get it. So when you plant that seed, we believe it isn't just words. When we believe there will be a trumpet sound, we believe the Lord will descend. There will be a shout so loud that the dead in Christ will be raised first. I'm about to preach myself happy here because I really believe that. Do you really believe that? That is the anchor of our hope. That we have a blessed hope. And so we want you to know there's no way we can really say we know how you feel. Because every one of them is unique. It's different. So we don't really know how you feel, but we feel for you and we feel with you. And we hope today that what we can do here to honor that memory and celebrate that life will just give you a boost to know that in the days to come, though they're gone, they will not be forgotten. I tell you what, the older I get, the harder it is to watch that scroll. But I'm just glad one of these days we're going to all go home. And I'd like for all of us, except the members of the family that are seated here, to stand, if you will. And I would like for you, and I know some people don't have comfort, a very high comfort level with this, but if you don't, that's okay. But if you feel comfortable, maybe you could just, I'm going to ask Brother Dean Caldwell to come and lead in prayer for this family. But I want, first of all of us just to stretch out your hand. There's no one in this room that's exempt from having some of the emotions that are going on right now. So could we just all pray that the Holy Spirit would buoy them up and would bless them, and then Brother Dean Caldwell is going to come and conclude in prayer.
Jesus, Lord, God, we worship you. We worship you. We just worship you, Lord. God, I magnify your name. I glorify you. How wonderful you are. Pray, God, for the comfort of these families today. I bless your name. Bless your name, Lord. Father, as we come to you today, we're so thankful in our heart and we're humbled. At the same time, because when we viewed these pictures, we knew every one of them. We have preached for them. We have served with them. We have eat with them. And God, we're so thankful for what they have given to the kingdom of God. We're not here today to question, Lord, how you took them, because I read in your word in Psalm 68 and 17 that the chariots of God are 20,000. That means, Lord, you've got at least 20,000 ways to get us out of here. And we're so thankful, Lord, that you have fulfilled to them your promise. He that believeth in me should not perish, but have everlasting life. God, you fulfill that to them. I thank you, Lord, for what they have placed in our life, the ministry that they have given, for their faithfulness to the kingdom of God. Now, God, we're praying for those that are left behind. I pray that you would touch them, you would comfort them. And I thank you, Lord, for those that are carrying on the ministry of the kingdom of God, even without their spouse and without mother and without father and without a brother or sister, they're carrying on the kingdom of God. I take David's prayer in Psalm 71 and verse 18. Lord, when he said, when I am old and gray-headed, forsake me not until I have shown thy strength to this generation and thy power to everyone that is to come. What he said, Lord, was I'm at an age that I can't be what I one time was. I can't do what I one time done. But I still remember the path to the throne and how to get there. I pray that you'd move today on these that are left behind and let them realize and know that they're not finished. They're not done, but they can still come to the church house and set and say, Lord, I'm a vessel for the river of God to flow through. Lord, our younger generation needs to know them and needs to see them. And I can identify when the Spirit of God moves on the premises. We need that, Lord. I pray comfort their hearts, comfort their lives, lift them up, and speak into them the comfort and the joy of God. Today we thank you. We thank you that we have the faithful promise of the blessed hope that one day soon, we'll see our loved ones again. God, they're not sick. They're not even old. They are renewed in the things of God, and they're waiting in the presence of God, alive and well. Bless, I pray, in Jesus' name, and we thank you, Lord. Amen.
If you remain standing just for a moment, we are actually not in business session yet, but we're going to have a pre-session before the session. And the chair would entertain a motion to transfer the membership of these who have been credentialed members of the Arkansas District Council from the Arkansas District Council to the Church of the Firstborn, the city of set on a hill, Mount Zion itself. Do I have a motion? All in favor say aye. It is done, and the Lord bless you as you are being seated today. God bless you. Thank you. We hope that we have helped today in the memory and celebrating the life of those that you love so well and that we love so well. We'll move now toward communion because I think it is not only fitting but ties together uniquely that communion is a celebration. It is a commemoration and a celebration, and it is a contemplation. Some of you that are pastors, you have a heavy load of conducting or of being the official leader of communion. And so sometimes that puts a little pressure on you. But I'd like for you today, how many of you, is there anyone who did not receive communion when you came in? If you'll hold up your hand, we have people, would our ushers please help us? If you did not receive communion when you came in, please hold up your hand. We want everyone to be served because serving and being served is a vital part of celebrating communion. Hallelujah. Lead us, Brother Ben, if you would, as we prepare our hearts and move toward communion.
Crimson love, price of life's demand, a shameful sin was placed on him, the hope of every man.
Take care of me, Ron.
Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. Save your son. The bread. precious blood of the Lamb. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. And oh, what love, no greater love. Grace, how can it be that in my sin, yes, even then, he shed his blood for me.
Would you take your bread this morning? Let's pray. Father, this morning our minds do trail back, realizing the provision that you made through a covenant meal with Abraham. Lord, we trace back how that through the Passover, that you reminded them through the unleavened bread who was to come, the spotless Lamb of God. Reminded that you were the manna that would come from heaven. And Lord, today we're reminded on many levels what this bread represents. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. But yet, you showed us the very human side and the price that would be paid. But Lord, a price that would bring us redemption. A price that would bring us righteousness. And you said, he that hungers and thirsts after righteousness will be filled. But then also we're reminded again of resurrection. Yes. And the hope that that brings. And today, Lord, as we participate in this, we pray that we would just be filled and reminded of the sacrifice that you made, yet also realizing the resurrection. And today we are thankful for resurrection life in us. And we're thankful and grateful to you for the great sacrifice that you made. In Jesus' name, let's take the bread.
We understand the significance of shed blood when the very first sin was committed upon earth. There was a blood sacrifice. And throughout the Old Testament, that theme is seen over and over. But then when we get into the New Testament, we understand that the blood of bulls and goats was not sufficient. But the precious blood of Christ was sufficient. I thank God for the blood. Father, thank you that you sent Jesus, who shed his blood that we might have life and forgiveness of sins. And he rose again to proclaim that the enemy has been defeated and we can be set free from sin. Thank you that the blood of Jesus Christ will never lose its power. It reaches every person from every generation, from every culture. Thank you for the power of your blood. We receive it now in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Shall we partake together?
Hallelujah. 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 Ooh, I sense something moving. The Holy Spirit makes that life. Hallelujah. So real. Aren't you glad you're clean? Aren't you glad you're cleansed? Aren't you glad you have resurrection power already working in you? I want us to sing, "Oh, the Blood of Jesus," but I just had this stray thought ricochet across my mind. It probably, I don't know how appropriate this is, but do you remember the first time you ever thought about your own blood as a child? I remember when I was a kid, and they would have they would have you hold your fingers together, you know, like this, and put them over your eyes and hold it up toward the sun, and you'd see pink in there. And somebody told me that was my blood. I could see my own blood. Of course, that's not probably true, because I think it's bluish or purplish or something, really, until it's oxygenated. But that just struck me, that the power of that fluid called the blood, the power of life that is there. And I'm glad that I don't even have to see my blood. I have seen the real blood. And I'm glad that my Father saw the blood and passed over me, and I am cleansed, and there is therefore now no condemnation, none whatsoever. Aren't you glad your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life today, because we celebrate communion? Can we just worship Him? I mean, just let it flow up out of your heart as we sing, "Oh, the blood of Jesus, it washes white as snow."
The blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. It washes white as snow.
Church, praise the Lord. Thank the Lord. You may be seated, and I thank you for participating with us in celebrating my best friend, the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to move now into something that is also very near and dear to the heart of our Master. Someone was telling me the other day, they were mentioning to me they were getting into missions. And I said, well, you just grabbed God by the heart when you did that, because the heart of God is missions. And Brother Colbert is coming to make some presentations now.
Thank you, Brother Moore. I want to say first, thanks of all, that we have a district superintendent who has a heart for missions. Thank you, sir. I know our council schedule is extremely tight, but he always makes room for us to have a special missions focus. We are honored today to have a special guest, David Grant. He's going to be coming in just a few moments. One of my joys in this role is getting to serve as your missions director and praying for missionaries, helping them with itineraries and support raising and beating the drum for them. But I also see one of my roles is to make you aware of various opportunities that we can be involved in expanding the kingdom of God around the world. I got an email, a special invitation to attend a meeting about Project Rescue. When I compared my calendar, I looked at Tina and I said, that's the week of our family vacation. What am I going to do? She looked at me and says, you're going to go. I'm a smart man. I asked my wife first, okay? So while on family vacation, I jumped on a plane and flew to Dallas. During that presentation, I knew that what the missions project for the 2018 District Council would be. And I said to myself, I cannot keep this to myself. I must give other people an opportunity to be involved in what God is doing around the world. Missionary David Grant, he preached my second youth convention. It was still held down at the campground. Brother David, you remember that? And so we've been together just about ever since. We bought a lot of bicycles and motorbikes and things like that for all these pastors he's worked with. Would you welcome missionary David Grant with Project Rescue?
Thank you, Cecil.
Yes, sir. Brother.
Thank you, Cecil. Yes, thank you, brother. Thank you, Arkansas. Not Alabama. Have mercy. Where is that? Thank you, Arkansas. I've been in about a half a dozen district councils in the last 10 days. And I want to say to you, you've given millions to missions. You've supported Speed the Light. You've supported Light for the Lost. You've supported BGMC. You have given to missions and missionaries all over the world. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart. And from missionaries all over the world, we want to say thank you, Arkansas. Thank you, thank you, thank you. It is, as the superintendent said, it is the heart of God. It's the heart of God. I was 12 years old when Charles Greenway came to my dad's church in Pensacola, Florida, and he told the story of a 12-year-old boy who had no money to put in the missionary offering. And when they passed the offering pan, he took the offering pan, the boy did, and said, Jesus, I don't have anything to give except myself, but you can have me. And he laid his offering, the offering pan on the floor and stood up in it. And Charles Greenway said that was the biggest missionary offering we ever received. 12-year-old boy standing in an offering plate. When he told that story, that night when they passed the offering pan, I said, God, if that other boy can do it, so can I. And I laid the offering pan on the floor, and I stood up in it. And the Holy Spirit spoke to my 12-year-old heart and said, David, you will go to India. And from the time I was 12 until today, I've been on my way to India. 48 years of building churches and preaching campaigns and building Bible schools. And then 20 years ago, we went into the Bombay Red Light District, where I had never been in 28 years in India. And through our Teen Challenge program, I walked into that area and found 100,000 girls in the brothels of Bombay. And God said, I have a new direction for you. 28 years, you built churches, you planted Bible schools, you preached campaigns all over this nation. Now we have 8,000 Assemblies of God churches in India and 1 million believers. He said, but there's a million girls that need somebody to champion their cause. I walked through the red light district at midnight and looked in the faces of 12-year-old girls, 13, 14, 15, knowing there were other girls younger than that up on the top floors of those brothels. I looked in their faces, their eyes were dead. They were girls who had been shattered, girls whose lives had been destroyed. Most of them would be dead before they were 19. And God said, these are my daughters. These are my daughters. David, I gave you two daughters. Both of them are now missionaries. I said, now I want you to have a million daughters. The first night, our teen challenge director, Devaraj, whom you'll see on the video in just one moment, stood in a street meeting and sent a call out to those brothels. If you can hear my voice, and if you call on Jesus, he will help you, and we will help you. The next night, over 100 girls had sent word back and said, we gave our hearts to your Jesus. Would you take our daughters to a place of safety? And Deborah had sent word back and said, tomorrow night, we'll be at a certain place. We'll take your daughters. They handed us 37 little girls the next night, right out of the brothels. We opened our first shelter. That was 20 years ago. 2 years ago, we had 37,000 girls that we touched by Project Rescue. Last year, 40,000 girls. And our dream is a million girls around the world who've been involved in sex trafficking and human trafficking, that God will rescue and restore those girls. That's been our dream now for 20 years. When you go by the Welcome Center, there's a free book called Beyond the Soil Curtain, the story of Project Rescue. God began to do some incredible journeys. And a year ago, we ran into a major crisis, an incredible crisis. After 20 years of reaching out to 40,000, and the doors were open in a dozen nations, but a crisis hit us, and Rod Loy and some friends championed this cause. And they called some of their friends to Dallas and said, we got to do something. And that day, something happened miraculously. Cecil Colbreth representing Arkansas, Rod Loy representing Arkansas, and the Potomac District, and many other districts where my wife is speaking there at the Potomac District Council today for this same cause, suddenly stood forward and said, we'll help. And in the last 7 months, we've had the most miraculous outpouring of finance and hearts and people and prayers we've had in our entire 20-year history. And I stand here today and say, Arkansas, thank you. Thank you, because you know how to respond. You know how to give. You know how to step up and say, there is a need, and we will meet it. I'm so glad to be here for this special memorial service. My dad pastored for 68 years, died at the age of 90. I started first grade in Lake Village, Arkansas, where Dad pastored for 8 months. So I am an Arkansas person. Mom died 4 years later at the age of 90. And when we gathered for that day, she told her doctor, she said, Dr. Torres, I'm going to heaven today. Don't slow me down. She was a glorious passing and a glorious funeral, with 5 children, 15 grandchildren, and a dozen great-grandchildren. As Pastor spoke last night here at the District Council, we have a heritage in our children. And I stand here today and I think of our children and my 2 daughters and 2 son-in-laws and 4 grandchildren. And I think of a million girls that you're going to see on the video in just a moment. And then Rod Loy is going to come and appeal to you to be part of a rescue day, when we set aside a day to rescue a million girls around this world and bring them to the shelter of Jesus Christ. The old song, rescue the perishing, care for the dying. Jesus is the miracle that changes everything. And I'm standing here today along with Cecil Colbreth and Rod Loy to say to you, as you watch this video, may God give you a passion and a vision that we can change the destiny of a million girls. And my dream is the marriage supper of the Lamb. I want you to stand at the door of the marriage supper of the Lamb and watch a million girls walk through that door that have been redeemed from the darkest parts of the world. We have purchased brothels and turned them into house churches. We have gone into the darkest places on this planet and said, there will be light. There will be light. The video, and then Ron Loy. Let's watch this video. Rescue Day.
The Lord led me to the red light district of Mumbai. There I saw a lot of children in the street. Two of the girls said to me, take us all out of this hell, otherwise we will all end up like our mothers.
Well, you know, I seen like my own daughters there. I said, what you do when you meet, when somebody take your daughters and you don't wait for United Nations or others to come to help you. You want to, you know, go and take your daughters from there. It's very hard because children born there, they don't know what is love. They have, you know, seen, you know, all this horror in their life. Because many children born there sometimes die. Also the girl child is sold, even they become 14, 13, then they have forced them into prostitution. It wasn't just rescue, it's not that, just go and rescue them. You have to earn their trust because their own family members or whom they trusted betrayed them. And one particular girl told me, they said, every time I would see you in the red light street walking, I used to hate you. When I see a man walking there, I want to go behind that man and want to knife them. I didn't like what they do to my mother. She said, I watched you very carefully then. And she said, one day I looked at your eyes. Something my heart touched, like my father. Like it? Love you. I mean, that you would take care of me. She spoke to her mother and she said, Mommy, I will go with this uncle to his home. After befriending these madams, these brothels, then they allow you to go inside and be there and sit with them and talk to them. I get an opportunity to pray for them. You go into like some kind of, you know, dungeon, really dark place. That's where I saw Sumi under the, you know, bed. The Sumi was like that, you know, just scared and lying, you know, up naked there. I said, she doesn't have anybody. I have a home, I can take her. I remember taking Sumi from that place, carrying her to my jeep, and she said, the house is moving. She said, the house is moving. So she lived most of her life in that dark room. They were all born in brothel, Sony, Sumi, Priya and Pinky. So when we got them, all of them very small age. I remember taking them in the bus all together. They getting out of the bus, seeing their house, they were jumping. Before they were just jumping up and down, and so happy just out of that hell to a home where, you know, they can just see their dates, so they are our home.
I am blessed to have good father like uncle. When he brought me here, I was such innocent girl, but because of him I have built that confidence in my life. He always makes sure that he can give us that love, and today we don't miss that love of father. Today he has completed me with the love of father, so I am blessed with him. Whatever I am today, it's all because of this Project Rescue. Whatever I needed, they have provided me everything. They are helping me to pursue my dreams, and it gave me hope for bright future.
And all of them graduated. Priya, she's doing a second year MBA. Soni, she finished her graduation and she's doing a master in arts. Pingy's also graduated and she's working also in a company. And Sumi graduated and she's working as an executive in a company. And their heart is what we have taught them. Not only they, God rescue them, save them from these places, not only for their own life, but through them God wants to save many, many others, raising them to be leaders for India. All I can say, look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done.
What began in the heart of David and Beth Grant has grown. We now have 16 sites in 8 country, and in the last 20 years, over 150,000 women and children have been ministered to through the ministry of Project Rescue. The stories are absolutely incredible, but for every testimony, there's also a story of tragedy. Human trafficking experts estimate that it's a $150 billion industry. The United Nations estimates over 21 million people are forced into human trafficking every year. Many victims go unreported. I've seen numbers that estimate as high as 100 million. The cost to provide a home, education, food, clothing, and medical care for a woman or child rescued from human trafficking is just $3 a day, $3. Those four girls you just saw, their care from the day they were found till the day they graduated high school was just over $19,500. Wouldn't you like to be able to raise your kid for under 20 grand? I can't feed my boys for under 20 grand. 20 grand sounds like a lot of money to realize. It's the entire cost of their childhood, $3 a day, $21 a week, $93 a month, $1,095 a year, completely pays for everything for a child who's been rescued. I believe in this ministry. David and Beth approached me a few months ago and asked me to take a position with Project Rescue, and I've taken that position. I'm not leaving my church. I'm just adding a responsibility. I've refused to accept any pay or reimburse any expenses. In fact, I've got a new book coming out, and all the money is going to Project Rescue because I want to invest in a ministry that matters. And my challenge to you today is to present the need to your church and to give them a chance to be involved and make a difference. I think sometimes we see a huge need, and the huge need is so overwhelming that we just don't know how we can make a difference. But everybody can make a difference in the life of one girl for $3. We presented Rescue Day 4 weeks ago at First Assembly North Little Rock. And that day was just a miraculous response. Over $110,000 came in that offering. You say, well, you had to have a lot of people there. Our campus in Valonia had the biggest missions offering in the history of our church. Over $10,000 that day came in for Rescue Day. If you give your people the opportunity to give, they'll respond. Every penny you give towards Project Rescue will go to Project Rescue. Every penny you give will go to rescue women and children from the evils of sex trafficking. You say, well, what about the 5% that comes out, that AGWM takes out? My church is committing to pay your 5%. So you can stand in front of your people, and you can say that every penny they give will go directly to the project. If you'll give the money through the district to Project Rescue, we'll pay your 5%. You say, well, what if we give $1 million? We'll take another offering, and we'll pay your 5%. You've got a piece of paper in your hand that looks like this. You can make a one-time gift, but what I want to challenge you to do is a rescue day, to present the opportunity to your people. We've got all the information you need on thumb drives. My team's around the room. In just a second, I'll give you a chance to raise your hand if you want one. It's got the video you just saw. It's got a shorter version of that video. It's got a promo video. It's got all the graphics. It's got instructions on how to do a rescue day. If you need help doing that, we'll help you. And just watch and see what God does. And we've discovered that when we present human trafficking, lost people are drawn to that. It's on their hearts as well, and we know that it's on God's heart. We also, Project Rescue, we need monthly support. I think there's a perception that we're an 800-pound gorilla and we've got thousands of churches supporting us. No, we only have 200 churches that support us on a monthly basis. If you would consider adding Project Rescue to your monthly support, I promise we'll be careful stewards of every dollar that you give. And girls like the girls you just saw will be rescued. I sat across from one of those girls a couple years ago. Her story was heartbreaking. She thought she'd going to another country to raise money to send home to her family, and when she got there, she found out she was going to be a sex slave. Took years before she escaped, and I'll never forget. We were sitting in a McDonald's in Eastern Europe, and she looked across the table at me, and she said, I just want to know, would someone like me be welcome in your church? Tears pouring down my face. I said, you're not only welcome in our church, you'll be loved in our church. Because we believe God has a destiny for you and a purpose for you. And what man has done to you, God's going to turn, and he's going to do incredible things in your life. And I'm honored to be a part of that. Would you bow your heads with me? Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for the ministry that you brought.